depression much of his life. I would like to tell you I'll never deal with it again. But I know I will, because I'm dealing with the same enemy all the time. Depression, stress, anxiety is epidemic in the U.S. It's pandemic in the world. Studies show that the depression, anxiety, people that are clinically depressed, it can be upwards of 30% in America. I think that record will go to 40 and 50 if we continue in the pace we are. We as a culture are killing ourselves from the inside out. We are prosperous. We have everything we could imagine. Everything. I will go home to an air-conditioned house, a refrigerator full of food. I have two cars. I have clothes, some clothes I never wear. My wife has shoes she'll never wear. I'm in trouble now. But I tell you, where there's a fruit, there's a root. What was the sin of Sodom? We also say, well, it was homosexuality. No, that was the symptom. That wasn't the cause. That wasn't the root. Now, I'm not going to make you go there, but if you want to write down Ezekiel chapter 16, verse 49. It says the sin of Sodom was this. They were arrogant, overfed, and unconcerned. And they did not care for the poor and the needy. Living life halted, and they had forgotten God. In that culture, they never had Him. I can tell you from years of counseling, looking at myself in the mirror, and dealing with others, that what I want to talk about today is either the root or after root of everything you're going to deal with. And if we as a church are going to experience a movement of God, we have to deal with this issue. Because as I begin to talk about it in a minute, you're going to find there's not one person in this room that does not have this issue. Because you're human, and you've had people come against you, attack you, wound you, do things in your life that you think you'll never, never, ever get over, and you'll never forget. Some of you are here today to heal that wound. Some of you are here today to numb that wound. Some of you are here today because you think if I don't do enough and do enough, I'll get over maybe what I did to somebody else. The Bible says there is a way of escape for every temptation. There is no temptation taking you such as is common to man. We all have it. But God is faithful, and He gives us a way of escape. A way of escape. He will not, actually says He will not give you more than you bear, but give you a way of escape. Well, actually, if you don't take His way of escape, it will be more than you can bear. Now, the Bible says, resist the devil and he'll flee from you, right? It actually says, submit to God, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. You've got to do exactly what the Bible says. You don't get to do it your way and then ask God to bless what you've changed. That's not how it works. I want to talk about an issue today that has has been the most crippling issue in my life. Though I would tell you that I'm not an unforgiving person, there is always at the core of most of our lives a root of something that we will not let go of. A root of something that has defined us and we will not let go of it. Something that has come into our lives that when God wants to touch it, it's the thing that we say, I cannot let go of this. What will happen? The two number one things that people say, it's not fair. And somebody's got to pay. Forgiveness is an unescapable issue for the purifying of your soul. In the book of Romans, Paul says in the first chapter, that the whole purpose of that book is to get the people that are reading it to not only walk in faith, I mean, not only receive Christ, the gospel by faith, but to walk in the obedience that comes from that. Now, I want to, as Stephen shared, he talked about how you've been made new and a new creation in Christ. And when Jesus Christ came into me when I was 15 years old, I knew that something had changed. And no matter all the stuff that I've done, the bad stuff, the wearying stuff, no matter, there was always at the core of my life that voice, that thing, that God that said, I own you. I will not let you go. You're a slave of my righteousness. And if you truly know the Lord, it is there. No matter how far a prodigal you go, no matter how far you go, you'll hear that voice that says, this is not for you. This is not where you belong. So Jesus Christ comes into the very core of my, very center of me, the Spirit, which was designed to be the temple of the Holy Spirit. And when I receive Christ, I actually become a partaker of His nature. I am as righteous as Christ. Now, for some people, that sounds blasphemous. But that's exactly what the Bible says in Romans chapter 3, Romans chapter 5. I have been given an unlimited grace and a free gift of righteousness. But see, you are spirit, soul, and body. You are a spirit who has a soul that lives in a body. You are not a human being, a soul trying to have a spiritual experience. You are a spirit living in a human experience. The soul part of me works right up here in my mind. Sometimes you'll read where it says spirit mind, spirit and mind. This right here is a renegade. This right here wants its own way. I want to think my thoughts when I want to think them. I want to do what I want to do when I want to do them. This right here is my issue. You know, Christ has come into me and He has already equipped me. The Bible says I'm already seated at the right hand of God. I didn't make that up. They can say Ephesians chapter 2. I'm seated at the right hand of the Father. That's what it says. Not right hand, but seated in the heavenlies. That's what that says. I'm actually seated in the heavenlies. But the spirit part of me, I mean the soul part of me, is still being saved. So though Christ has moved into me, some assembly is required. And there are areas that I simply do not want to let God go to. I don't want the Holy Spirit touch. Now, what I'm going to ask you to do, and I'm going to try to do this in time, but if I told you I'd be short, you know I was lying. So, Hebrews chapter 12. I'm going to try to go through this, not get bogged down, but I want you to hear what this says. Hebrews is talking about coming into faith in Christ, coming out of dead religion, coming out of Judaism, that was not that it wasn't wonderful, it's been fulfilled. And now in Jesus Christ, we have a better Savior, we have a better covenant, we have a better hope, we have better promises, we have everything made on a person of Jesus Christ. And then in the 11th chapter, he says, and that is all lived out by faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. By faith, the ancients, by faith, Abel, by faith, Abraham, by faith, on and on, Moses. And then when he gets to the 12th chapter, he says, now, let's get to the nitty-gritty of how that is lived out every day. Therefore, seeing we surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, the people who walk by faith, going back to Abraham, going back to Abel, going back all the way, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely. And let us run with endurance the race that is set out before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. There are some things in your life that are not a sin, but they're a faith. They're a hindrance that's keeping you going forward with God. And because they're not an out-and-out sin, because I'm not cheating on my wife or my husband, I'm not cheating on my income taxes, I'm not blowing up every night, I'm trying to deal with what comes out of my mouth, because I can't classify them as a sin, I have pretty much said, okay, they're just there, and there's nothing I can do about it. They're just a way, they're just a hindrance, and God, He's okay with that. No, He's not. that Christ is Lord. He's not just your Father. He's your Lord. And he says every area, every thought, every attitude, every choice. Looking unto Jesus, running the race. Now, if I'm going to run a race, I'm going to establish the end of it about to that wall because that's about all I got. But Jesus sets the markers. And I'm going to tell you, there's a time when I'm like, I can't go anymore. I can't go anymore. I've got to. He says, keep going. You ever notice there in Isaiah chapter 40 where it says, those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. I used to wonder, why does it say you run and then you walk? Because when I was a young pastor, I remember it was like, got this, just go. I'm going, I'm booking, I'm going to save the world, I'm going to touch the world. And somewhere around the line of all of it in my Christian life, I slowed to a walk. Are you with me? And I said, I'm still walking. There are times when the walk became a crawl. There are sometimes the crawl became, I'm just standing and I'm trying not to back up. This is a real battle. It's a real fight every day of our lives. And Jesus is the one we look to. Now, when I look to Jesus, and this is going to be very important, the author and finisher, the founder and perfecter, who for the joy set before him, the joy set before him on the other side. James chapter 1 says, let patience have her perfect work in the King James. Every other one says, it, but her is right. It's the guide of a woman in labor. And I've sat through all of Robin's deliveries. And I got to tell you, I'm so glad men don't have to do that. And I remember after Zachary was born, after I think it was 12 hours of labor, there was a moment in it. Robin sat up, put her arms on my shoulders, and looked at me and said, never again. And I remember the next day, she's holding Zachary, a little newborn. She's holding him there, and I said, do you remember all, pain? Was it hard? She goes, she didn't remember. Because of the joy set before her. The pain went into the background. But there's so many of us that are nursing that pain for everything we are, and we can never go to joy because we've let our pain define us. On the night that Jesus, before he was crucified, he was in a garden praying drops of blood. The prayer he was praying was not, Lord, I'm looking so forward to tomorrow. I can't wait for it to begin because I know I'm going to be shielded from all the pain that happens. I know when they beat me with that cat of nine tails, I will feel nothing. I know when they hang me on that cross because you're going to put a supernatural grace bubble around me where I don't have to ever deal with pain or any of that stuff, and I'm just looking forward to it. What Jesus actually prayed was, if it is possible, let this cup pass. Now, this is the Son of God. The Son of God. And the Father said, no. You have to do it. Hebrews chapter 5 says Jesus learned obedience from the things he suffered. I want you to keep reading, and let's go with the story it says. Verse 3, consider him who endures from sinners such hostility against himself so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. And your struggle against sin you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding the blood. Some of us have come very close. Some of us are maybe going through something right now that we think, I don't know if I take another step. I don't know how we're going down the way. The things that are coming against me, the things that are being done, the things that are being said, where I'm going to. I'm finding myself that I don't even think I can stand anymore. And you have forgotten the exhortation that addresses you that says, my son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be wearied when reproved by him, for the Lord disciplines everyone he loves and chastens every son whom he receives. This is part of it. There's a lot of teaching today, if you go online, and they're telling us in the name, this is your year of faith. This is your year of victory. This is the year where all your dreams come true. This is the year where even your family, they all receive better jobs. They all get better cars. They all, because this is the dream. And God now is going to make sure that your every prayer is answered and your every dream is fulfilled, because God is the dream maker and the dream fulfiller, and God is working that in your life. And now by faith, you're going to conquer every mountain and destroy. And the fact of the matter, that's just not true. Sometimes faith hangs on and asks God, by God's grace, to help me from letting go. For it is for discipline that you endure. I love how the NIV says it. Endure hardship is discipline. I'm going to say that again. Have an NIV. I love how it says that. Endure hardship as discipline. Meaning what? God is treating you as sons. For what son? And that's generic. Sons and daughters. For what child, we could say, is there whom the father does not discipline? If you are left without discipline, in which you have all participated, you are illegitimate children and not sons. Besides this, we have earthly fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short while as it seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good, that we may share in his holiness. I want to stop right there. He disciplines you so you will share in his holiness. This is a huge deal. I thought you said I had already been made holy. Yes, but now that holiness has to get into your soul. And now the way it gets into your soul is he breaks down everything that you are going to hold against him. Everything, every weight that is holding you back, he's going to come against it. And I'm going to say something, I'm going to come back to it. The greatest wounds you receive in life are not from Satan. They are from God. Well, where do you get that from? Hosea chapter 6, he has torn us that he may heal us. God will let things come into your life that you would not let come into your child's life because you are overprotected. God will let me go through something that you're going to say, where are you? Why have you let this happen? Is this the way it's always going to be? It just is. I'm sorry. I would love to rewrite the story, but I don't get to do that. Jesus is our example, in that if you're going to walk with the Father, we have to deny ourselves, take up our cross daily. I don't mean the one that hangs around your neck or you hang on your ears. I mean a form of execution and follow. Now, I love the term, let's follow Jesus, but you've got to do everything that goes before it. You have to deny yourself. Remember the sin of Sodom? It was all about me. We are living in such a narcissistic world, folks. Narcissism to the max. I don't know how we come back from where we are, but I want to say something. We like to take the prophecies of the Old Testament and say, man, that really describes America. Yeah, America is screwed up. You've got to remember something. The prophets in the Old Testament were talking to the people of God. Today, that would correspond to the church. It is interesting that in 2 Timothy chapter 3, when Paul says, in the end, perilous times will come. Sometime today, read that. He is not talking about what the world will be. He's talking about what the church will become. Because he ends it by saying, having a form of godliness, but denying the power. It is interesting. We have a double standard. We like to take the blessings of God, of the prophets in the Old Testament, and make it all about us. But the warnings, we like to make it all about them. And I I can tell you that the reason America is in the state it's in is because God's people have not humbled themselves and prayed and sought His face and turned from their wicked ways. Because then He will hear from heaven. He will forgive their sin and heal them. Judgment always begins at the house of God. It comes in like judgment day. What point are you making? I'm taking a point of this. This is why listen how he ends this. He says, at the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant. But it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. I've got to tell you, there are times that God's training is almost more than I can bear. But there is a way of escape. What is that? Verse 12, therefore lift up your drooping hands and strengthen your weakness. I know you're tired. I know it's tough. Right now you've got to remember, these Jewish Christians coming out of the temple, coming out of Judaism, they were losing everything. They were being persecuted. They lost homes. They lost families. These people lost everything to become Jesus. Families disowned them. Wives disowned husbands. Husbands disowned wives. Children disowned parents. Parents disowned children. They were losing everything to walk with Jesus. In America, you may have some people wonder at you and make fun of you, but you really don't lose anything like that. That time may come. But he's telling them, all right, you're worn out. Make straight paths for your feet. What? Make a straight path for your feet, so that what is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather healed. What's the straight path? Straight to Jesus. Straight to the truth. Straight to the Word. We say, I want to be like Jesus. I heard Henry Blackaby say this many years ago. He said, Lord, I was praying one time. He said, Lord, I want to be like Jesus. He said, well, turn to Isaiah 53 and write down where it says, when you've been despised and rejected of men, write that day down. That's when you're becoming like Jesus. He said, no, Lord, I wanted to walk on water. I wanted to raise the dead and heal the sick. But you don't wear the crown that you bear the cross. We tried to skip it. Satan offered it to Jesus. He said, if you bow down to me, I'll give you the whole world. He took it. Jesus could have skipped it all. He said, no. The way to my crown is through a cross. The way to your crown is through a cross. But no one likes it. I don't like it. There's times that I don't want to do what God wants me to do. I would love to say I wake up every morning and say, what's the plan? Let's go. There's sometimes I wake up every morning and say, you got something for me? Let's start running home. See to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springs up and causes trouble, and by it many become defiled. That no one is it sexually immoral or unholy like Esau, who sold his birthright for a single meal? Make every effort to be at peace with all men. I think I missed that. Strive for peace with everyone and for holiness. Let me read that again. Strive for peace with everyone. Let me read that again. Strive for peace with everyone. One more time. Strive for peace with everyone. It doesn't say whoever comes to you and asks for forgiveness. Strive for peace with everyone. Be at peace with all men. And for holiness, without which no one will see them. We have so simplified salvation till we say, if I pray this prayer, I'm okay. And there are many people in churches who have prayed a prayer that have never, ever been born again. Be real. If he man is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things passed away, everything is becoming. If I have truly come into Christ and nothing has changed, nothing is going on, and I'm just going away, then you've got to ask yourself, is this because you have invited the Holy Spirit of God in your life? He who said, let there be light, and there was light, and he can't come in your life and begin to at least cause the disruption. It comes down to this. If I'm going to be in relationship, I know my time is going, so hang on. If I'm going to be in a relationship, it calls for me to be responsible. We've lost that term today. Everyone has rights, but no one wants to be responsible. I believe last night I had a vision that I was actually a 64-year-old woman, and my pronouns now are they and them. There was a time, 50 years ago, you said that man needs help. But in our culture today, and many of our church cultures, you say, well, we can't speak against that. We might offend them. Yeah. When Jesus had the 5,000 and he fed them that day, and I've said this before, so this won't be anything new. But you know those 12 were like, this is it. This is the beginning of the movement. This is where it happens. This is grassroots. This is now where we go. And this 10,000 becomes 20,000 and 40,000. And then when we get an army and Jesus stands up like Joshua of old and in the white charger, and we come like the days of the Maccabees, where we go in and the Maccabees kick the Greeks out. We're going to kick the Romans out. And there's going to be a whole new Camelot, a day of movement, a day of restoration of the Jewish kingdom. And it's going to be, and Jesus says, eat my flesh and drink my blood. And they all went. Don't you know they wanted to have a meeting and say, you know, for certain things we can't say that because we want to make sure that no one gets offended. We want to make sure everybody comes back. Apparently Jesus didn't think that way. So much like Jesus said, if they've been with me 3 days, and all of them are here, they still don't get it. We walk into church and say, let me make sure I preach a message that hits everybody. Then there's no way. The message any pastor preaches will be for those who have eyes to see and ears to hear. And then they say, if you remember, this is a hard saying. Who can deal with it? And Jesus says, does it offend you? My words are spirit in their life. He didn't say, I'm sorry. He's saying, this is the thing. You've got to make a choice whether I'm going to be Lord or you're going to be Lord, because I'm going to speak in your life, and I'm going to speak hard things in your life, and I'm going to tell you to deal with things that you think there's no way I can deal with, and I'm going to ask you to forgive things that you think there's no way to forgive them, and I'm going to tell you that I'm Lord, and the only way you truly learn to be like Jesus and really go on, young men that want to be in ministry, is I have to break you down to all you have is me. How many takers do we have now? There's 12 guys sitting there going, and he says, you're going to leave two. And I wonder what Peter says, where would we go? We don't have anywhere else to go. We've tried everything else. So we're going to have to retool our thinking, because obviously what we're seeing is wrong. Obviously it's not about the big crowds. Obviously it's not about that anymore. Here's what he said. See to it. This is your responsibility. See to it, verse 15. You see, the same heading should actually head up 16. See to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springs up and causes trouble, and by it many be defied. See to it that no one is sexually immoral. There are two major issues that you're going to have to deal with in your life if you're going to truly walk under the discipline of God and deal with what God wants. The first one is the issue of grace. You cannot allow any offense to keep you away from seeking the heart of God. I don't care what it is. There is no offense that you can let come into your life, that you let take root and become a root of bitterness, and then spring up and defile men. You are responsible for dealing with that. You. God, take this away. Take this feeling away. Just make it that I don't feel the hurt anymore. It simply doesn't work that way. Faith calls for obedience. Not simply praying a prayer and God takes it all away. The impurity, not allowing any desire to go outside of God's design, especially sexually. So the absence of these sets up a stronghold. I'm going to tell you this. These two issues will short-circuit faith quicker than anything you will have. Sexual immorality, we see, but I've got to tell you that unforgiveness is just on par with it. In Mark chapter 11, when Jesus had cursed the fig tree and it died, and Peter's like, wow, you cursed it, and it's dead right now. He says, yeah, have faith in God, and when you do, you'll set this mountain, be cast into the sea, you will be able to pray anything in faith, and you'll see it happen. But if you have anyone that you need to forgive, if you don't forgive them, there won't be forgiveness, and it goes on. What was it? How in the middle of a faith talk does he suddenly get to the issue of forgiveness? So he's telling you that if you don't deal with the issue of forgiveness, it will short-circuit everything God's doing in your life. Now, we understand that sexually. If a guy comes in and says, hey, you know what? I got a real love for Jesus. I think he's calling me, but I've got this girlfriend on the side, and do you think it's okay? Sure, why not? God's grace put all under the banner of grace. Why not? God calls all kinds, doesn't he? No, God calls the obedient. God calls the faithful. So what does that mean? It means this. That in the context of what I've just read, that the issue of forgiveness is on the same par as sexual immorality. Meaning, the issue of forgiveness does as much damage in my life and the life of those that I'm related to as much as if I were committing adultery. I'm going to say it again. The issue of unforgiveness in your life is on the same par as if you went out and committed adultery. It's on the same par if you spent 3 hours on a porn site. It does the same damage in your life, ladies, because most of you say, I would never go there. It will do the same damage in your life that does in life. Some of us are proud of the things we won't forgive. Some of us, well, here's what we say. Because understand that when you're unforgiving, it goes, takes root, and then it springs up, and it begins like a ripple effect to work into every relationship you have. And when you keep it, it'll eventually work its way and eventually destroy the most key relationships in your life because you won't let something go that happened 10 years ago. You may say to me, well, I can't just override my feelings. I'm hearing on TV a lot today, you don't choose who you will love. Where did we come up with that hobby? Robin walked in a room, and I went, then on it was a magnetic effect, and I had no choice as I was her zombie. Man, I had to work to get this woman. I've got to tell you, it was not easy. And when you look at the two of us, you will know why. You're the most honest person in the room. Thank you. And so I didn't just say, well, choose who I love. Now, I don't mean this to be mean, but I believe if I had not married Robin, that I could have chosen another person, and if we had chosen to follow the Lord, we could have had the same good relationship too. Is there that one person that God has for you, and if you don't have them, you live in second best? Like, no. Robin and I saw each other, and we said, we want to build a Christian home together. We're going to work at this. We're going to grow in this. It's going to be everything we have. We're going to give it, and we're going to give ourselves, and we're going to be two good forgivers, and we're going to make sure that Jesus Christ stays Lord, and we're going to choose who we love. On the other end, well, I can't just get over what's been done to me. Now, let's understand something, and I know I'm taking too long, but listen to me. When I get hurt, when I get offended, I get hurt every time. The Bible says you can be angry and sin not. I get angry every time. All right, I'm at the point now, what am I going to do with it? If I let that thing go underground, if I hold on to it, it's going to begin then to take and become a foothold of the enemy. And then it becomes a root of bitterness in my life. And what that root of bitterness does is offense, anger, and then on this end of it, I've got a choice to make. Whether I, by determination, am going to forgive, because it's not the natural thing. It's a determination thing. By determination, I am going to forgive. I'm going to do what God told me to do, even when I don't like it, even when it hurts, because I want to keep my life open. On this end, I'm going to choose bitterness by default and put walls up in front of my life which better never, ever, ever fall. I want to say this, that bitterness is not only a defiler, it's a decision. Love is not a feeling, it's a choice, it's a responsibility. Love is patient, it's kind. That's what the Bible says. It doesn't say it's a wonderful feeling I have. It's when the birds are chirping and the bells are ringing. I asked an older couple one time from the pulpit, I said, are the bells still ringing? They've been married about 60 years. He said, hardly. To keep bells ringing and birds chirping, I got to work at this. It's the willing to honor and serve. It's the willing to remain faithful. It's the willingness to make unfailing. It's the willingness to say, whatever you have done to me, I release. It will not define me. It will not own me. We will move on if we're both willing to seek the Lord in this. Bitterness is the most natural choice. And it may be that you're choosing consciously to hang on to your hurt and stay angry. Well, that's obvious. But what most of us do is seemingly do nothing. We just choose to hang on to it by default. And we live in denial and deception and say, I'm not angry. I'm not bitter. But all the evidence shows that you are. If every week you saw me putting on 3 extra pounds, and to the point that 10 weeks from now I couldn't fit in this anymore, and I said, I don't know what the problem is, I'm not overeating, you know I was lying, wouldn't you? You said, come out of your deception. Denial's not just a river in Egypt, right? And yet I watch people who are living in constant, but they won't call it bitterness. Well, I don't call it anger. I'm disappointed. I'm just mad. The fact of the matter, at the root of your disappointment, the root of your disillusionment, is an offense that you never let go of, and it's now become a root of bitterness, and it's running out in 1,000 different ways, but it has put a stop on your walk with the Lord. Because how do we know? Because the Bible says we have to, let us not grieve the Holy Spirit of God. In fact, it should come up here, Ephesians 4:30. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, for whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. I don't understand why I can't seem to connect with God. I don't understand why I can't seem to shake my anxiety and depression. I don't understand why none of my relationships seem healthy. I don't understand why I need pills and alcohol and porn just to get through. Because you're grieving the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit says, you feel that inside of you, that's not Robin's fault, James. That's yours. That's yours to not let it go. I'm the one with the problem. I'm the one with the problem. We were at a men's encounter and we talked a lot about father wounds. I can honestly say I don't have one. I'm not saying my dad was perfect, but my dad and I had a wonderful relationship. Wonderful. I can't say I have a father wound or a mother wound. That doesn't mean that I didn't have a strange family. We all did. And I was probably the strangest. Dunkling is a wonderful place to go to. You can feel the Spirit of God there, like it's just there. It's saturated. Which is what revival is, to keep us saturated in God. But there's a little boy buried there that never reached his second birthday. And I've lost a brother and I've lost a father, but nothing like losing a child. And especially when it was violent. He was taken, thrown, his brain shifted, and he bled through the night, and he died. I believe he died then, and they kept him alive for a week. My life came to a halt. Some of you have gone through that. Some of you may not have lost a child through death, but the relationship you had with that child is so damaged now, it's like they're dead. And I truly believe that the man who did it, I don't ever really ever think about him. I truly forgave him. You know what my hardest part was with God. Well, if we're pious, we'll say, well, God didn't do anything. Exactly. God did. He didn't do anything. He was there when that little boy was taken and thrown. He didn't stop it. He was there when that little boy lay in the hospital room and he didn't heal him and he didn't resurrect him. In 30-some years of serving him, and when I needed him the most, he wasn't there. I know I'm speaking for many of you. When you need him the most in your marriage, he was not there. When you need him the most in your job and your career, he was not there. When you need him the most, when you need him the most, and years of saying he's Lord, and when you need him the most, he simply seemed not to be there. But we know, in reality, that's not true. But our mind is hard to accept it. Jesus said, my God, why have you forsaken me? He knows your pain. He knows what it means to feel like everybody's forsaken. Where were you, Father? Why did you? Where were you? Because where you're going in that, this is wounding that brings healing. And I don't understand it. I would rewrite it, but it's the way it is. And if you're going to truly walk with God, you're going to truly experience revival, you're going to have to develop a repentance, a change of mind that says, if he slay me, I will trust him. You'll say, I don't understand. I know I don't. You'll say, mine was different. Mine was I used to counsel for years out of theory, and I could walk you through the theory. Now I just cry with you. I just cry with you. There's some pain so deep that all you can do is weep through them and get to the other side. Tears may last for the night, but joy comes in the morning. It comes down to this. Will Jesus be Lord of everything that happens in my life? The good and the bad. Job lost 7 children in 1 day. 7 children in 1 day. His wife had cursed God and died. Oh man, where's her faith? He lost 7 children in 1 day. That dear lady lost 7 children in 1 day. Let's give her a break. Had to remind us, so I not only received good, but harm. I don't get to define God. I don't get to tell him how he works. I don't get to tell him why my stuff is bigger than anybody else's and why my stuff should be given a pass. I don't get to tell him why I can't forgive this and you need to leave me alone. It's not about getting over it. It's about giving it over to Jesus. And I'm going to finish with this. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32, it says this. It's going to come up on the screen, hopefully. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 36. If not, I got it here. Listen to what it says. Be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, because God in Christ forgave you. It's not what it says. It says, as God in Christ forgave you. Jesus said, God will forgive them, and they won't forgive them. It wasn't a trip of passion. I got to tell you, there's not a time where I don't watch that video, where I was suddenly in a Rambo moment for him to come down and grab that whip and say, not today. And then I want him to go Rambo, and I want him to tear the whole place up, and not a soul survivor. But he was wounded for your transgressions. He was bruised for your iniquity. The chastisement for your peace was upon him, and by his stripes you were healed. All we, like sheep, had gone astray. We had all turned our own way, and the Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all. And Jesus took your sin, and he went into the holy place in the unseen world, and on the throne of the Father, he laid it down, and he that knew no sin became sin for you, that he might give his righteousness to people who would never deserve it, but have been given a gift. That's how we forgive. Forgiveness is a gift that no one else deserves. If you hang on to that forgiveness, you basically create a soul tie with the offender, and you turn around the rest of your life and help them abuse you. Don't you want to live before you die? When I was a little boy, I was a powder. Any of you a powder? Oh, don't look at me like that. You know you were. You were whiners, criers. I'd get hurt. And my dad had this way of coming, and he would just nudge me. Get up. Get up. You can't stand. Get up. Shut it up. Just move on. Get up. Forgetting that which is behind, and reaching forward to that which is ahead. There is a greater grace than the sin that has been done to you. There is a greater grace than the sin that you have done to others. There is a greater grace than your past. There is a greater grace than your woundedness, and you have got to tap into it, or you'll live your life in excuses. We have a whole nation right now that doesn't even know what their gender or their pronoun is because they have identified themselves by their confusion and their pain. And the church is not immune to it. If Christ be Lord, follow him. Do not just the right way. It's not just the best way. It's the only way. I know we've had time at the altar. You can't wear it out. And I believe there's some people today that just simply need to get up. To move on. To believe in Jesus. There's not a day in my life that I don't think about that little boy. I want out. But he does not define me. When I was standing before you, and we would have been worshiping. So the altar is open.